This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Books and Habits from the Lectures of Lafcadio Hearn by Lafcadio Hearn. Chapter 1: The Insuperable Difficulty. I wish to speak of the greatest difficulty with which the Japanese students of English literature, or of almost any Western literature, have to contend. I do not think that it ever has been properly spoken about. A foreign teacher might well hesitate to speak about it, because if he should try to explain it merely from the Western point of view, he could not hope to be understood, and if he should try to speak about it from the Japanese point of view, he would be certain to make various mistakes and to utter various extravagances. The proper explanation might be given by a Japanese professor only, who should have so intimate an acquaintance with Western life as to sympathize with it. Yet I fear that it would be difficult to find such a Japanese professor, for this reason, that just in proportion as he should find himself in sympathy with Western life, in that proportion he would become less and less able to communicate that sympathy to his students. The difficulties are so great that it has taken me many years even to partly guess how great they are. That they can be removed at the present day is utterly out of the question. But something may be gained by stating them even imperfectly. At the risk of making blunders and uttering extravagances, I shall make the attempt. I am impelled to do so by a recent conversation with one of the cleverest students that I ever had, who acknowledged his total inability to understand some of the commonest facts in Western life, all those facts relating directly or indirectly to the position of woman in Western literature as reflecting Western life. Let us clear the ground at once by putting down some facts in the plainest and lowest terms possible. You must try to imagine a country in which the place of the highest virtue is occupied, so to speak, by the devotion of sex to sex. The highest duty of the man is not to his father, but to his wife, and for the sake of that woman he abandons all other earthly ties, should any of these happen to interfere with that relation. The first duty of the wife may be, indeed must be, to her child, when she has one, but otherwise her husband is her divinity and king. In that country, it would be thought unnatural or strange to have one's parents living in the same house with wife or husband. You know all this. But it does not explain for you other things, much more difficult to understand, especially the influence of the abstract idea of woman upon society at large, as well as upon the conduct of the individual. The devotion of man to woman does not mean at all only the devotion of husband to wife. It means actually this, that every man is bound by conviction and by opinion to put all women before himself, simply because they are women. I do not mean that any man is likely to think of any woman as being his intellectual and physical superior, but I do mean that he is bound to think of her as something deserving and needing the help of every man. In time of danger, the woman must be saved first. In time of pleasure, the woman must be given the best place. In time of hardship, the woman's share of the common pain must be taken voluntarily by the man as much as possible. This is not with any view to recognition of the kindness shown. The man who assists a woman in danger is not supposed to have any claim upon her for that reason. He has done his duty only, not to her, the individual, but to womankind at large. So we have arrived at this general fact, that the first place in all things, except rule, is given to woman in Western countries, and that it is given almost religiously. Is woman a religion? Well, perhaps you will have the chance of judging for yourselves if you go to America. There you will find men treating women with just the same respect, formerly accorded only to religious dignitaries or to great nobles. Everywhere they are saluted and helped to the best places, everywhere they are treated as superior beings. Now if we find reverence, loyalty, and all kinds of sacrifices devoted either to a human being or to an image, we are inclined to think of worship. And worship it is. If a Western man should hear me tell you this, he would want the statement qualified, unless he happened to be a philosopher. But I am trying to put the facts before you in the way in which you can best understand them. Let me say then that the all-important thing for the student of English literature to try to understand is that in Western countries woman is a cult, a religion, or if you like still plainer language, I shall say that in Western countries woman is a god. So much for the abstract idea of woman. Probably you will not find that particularly strange. The idea is not altogether foreign to Eastern thought, and there are very extensive systems of feminine pantheism in India. Of course, the Western idea is only in the romantic sense of feminine pantheism, but the Oriental idea may serve to render it more comprehensive. The ideas of Divine Mother and Divine Creator may be studied in a thousand forms. I am now referring rather to the sentiment, to the feeling, than to the philosophical conception. You may ask if the idea or sentiment of divinity attaches to woman in the abstract, what about woman in the concrete, individual woman? Are women individually considered as gods? Well, that depends on how you define the word God. The following definition would cover the ground, I think. Gods are beings superior to man, capable of assisting or injuring him, and to be placated by sacrifice and prayer. Now, according to this definition, I think that the attitude of man towards woman in Western countries might be very well characterized as a sort of worship. In the upper classes of society, and in the middle classes also, great reverence towards women is exacted. Men bow down before them, make all kinds of sacrifices to please them, beg for their goodwill and their assistance. It does not matter that this sacrifice is not in the shape of incense burning or of temple offerings, nor does it matter that the prayers are of a different kind from those pronounced in churches. There is sacrifice and worship. And no saying is more common, no truth better known, than that the man who hopes to succeed in life must be able to please the women. Every young man who goes into any kind of society knows this. It is one of the first lessons that he has to learn. Well, am I very wrong in saying that the attitude of men towards women in the West is much like the attitude of men towards gods? But you may answer at once, how comes it, if women are thus reverenced as you say, that men of the lower classes beat and ill-treat their wives in those countries? I must reply, for the same reason that Italian and Spanish sailors will beat and abuse the images of the saints and virgins to whom they pray, when their prayer is not granted. It is quite possible to worship an image sincerely, and to seek vengeance upon it in a moment of anger. The one feeling does not exclude the other. What in the higher classes may be a religion, in the lower classes may be only a superstition, and strange contradictions exist, side by side, in all forms of superstition. Certainly, the Western working man or peasant does not think about his wife or his neighbor's wife in the reverential way that the man of the superior class does. But you will find, if you talk to them, that something of the reverential idea is there. It is there at least during their best moments. Now there is a certain exaggeration in what I have said. But that is only because of the somewhat narrow way in which I have tried to express a truth. I am anxious to give you the idea that throughout the West there exists, though with a difference according to class and culture, a sentiment about women quite as reverential as a sentiment of religion. This is true, and not to understand it is not to understand Western literature. How did it come into existence? Through many causes, some of which are so old that we cannot know anything about them. This feeling did not belong to the Greek and Roman civilization, but it belonged to the life of the old northern races, who have since spread over the world, planting their ideas everywhere. In the oldest Scandinavian literature, you will find that women were thought of and treated by the men of the north very much as they are thought of and treated by Englishmen of today. You will find what their power was in the old sagas, such as the Injal saga or the story of Burnt Injal. But we must go much further than the written literature to get a full knowledge of the origin of such a sentiment. The idea seems to have existed that woman was semi-divine because she was the mother, the creator of man. And we know that she was credited among the Norsemen with supernatural powers. But upon this northern foundation, there was built up a highly complex fabric of romantic and artistic sentiment. The Christian worship of the Virgin Mary harmonized with the northern belief. The sentiment of chivalry reinforced it. Then came the artistic resurrection of the Renaissance, and the new reverence for the beauty of the old Greek gods and the Greek traditions of female divinities. These also colored and lightened the old feeling about womankind. Think also of the effect with which literature, poetry, and the arts have since been cultivating and developing the sentiment. Consider how the great mass of Western poetry is love poetry, and the greater part of Western fiction love stories. Of course, the foregoing is only the vaguest suggestion of a truth. Really, my object is not to trouble you at all about the evolutional history of the sentiment, but only to ask you to think what this sentiment means in literature. I am not asking you to sympathize with it, but if you could sympathize with it, you would understand 1,000 things in Western books which otherwise must remain dim and strange. I am not expecting that you can sympathize with it, but it is absolutely necessary that you should understand its relation to language and literature. Therefore, I have to tell you that you should try to think of it as a kind of religion, a secular, social, artistic religion, not to be confounded with any national religion. It is a kind of race feeling or race creed. It has not originated in any sensuous idea, but in some very ancient superstitious idea. Nearly all forms of the highest sentiment and the highest faith and the highest art have had their beginnings in equally humble soil. End of the chapter. Chapter 2 on Love in English Poetry. I often imagine that the longer he studies English literature, the more the Japanese student must be astonished at the extraordinary predominance given to the passion of love, both in fiction and in poetry. Indeed, by this time I have begun to feel a little astonished at it myself. Of course, before I came to this country, it seemed to me quite natural that love should be the chief subject of literature, because I did not know anything about any other kind of society except Western society. But today it really seems to me a little strange. If it seems strange to me, how much more ought it to seem strange to you? Of course, the simple explanation of the fact is that marriage is the most important act of man's life in Europe or America, and that everything depends upon it. It is quite different on this side of the world. But the simple explanation of the difference is not enough. There are many things to be explained. Why should not only the novel writers, but all the poets make love the principal subject of their work? I never knew, because I never thought, how much English literature was saturated with the subject of love, until I attempted to make selections of poetry and prose for class use, naturally endeavoring to select such pages or poems as related to other subjects than passion. Instead of finding a good deal of what I was looking for, I could find scarcely anything. The great prose writers, outside of the essay or history, are nearly all famous as tellers of love stories. and it is almost impossible to select half a dozen stanzas of classic verse from Tennyson or Rossetti or Browning or Shelley or Byron, which do not contain anything about kissing, embracing, or longing for some imaginary or real beloved. Wordsworth, indeed, is something of an exception, and Coleridge is most famous for a poem which contains nothing at all about love. But exceptions do not affect the general rule that love is the theme of English poetry, as it is also of French, Italian, Spanish, or German poetry. It is the dominant motive. So with the English novelists. There have been here also a few exceptions, such as the late Robert Louis Stevenson, most of whose novels contain little about women. They are chiefly novels or romances of adventure. But the exceptions are very few. At the present time, there are produced almost every year in England about 1,000 new novels, and all of these, or nearly all, are love stories. To write a novel without a woman in it would be a dangerous undertaking. In 99 cases out of 100, the book would not sell. Of course, all this means that the English people throughout the world, as readers, are chiefly interested in the subject under discussion. When you find a whole race interested more in one thing than in anything else, you may be sure that it is so, because the subject is of paramount importance in the life of the average person. You must try to imagine, then, a society in which every man must choose his wife, and every woman must choose her husband, independent of all outside help, and not only choose but obtain if possible. The great principle of Western society is that competition rules here as it rules in everything else. The best man, that is to say, the strongest and cleverest, is likely to get the best woman in the sense of the most beautiful person. The weak, the feeble, the poor, and the ugly have little chance of being able to marry at all. Tens of thousands of men and women cannot possibly marry. I am speaking of the upper and middle classes. The working people, the peasants, the laborers, these marry young, but the competition there is just the same, just as difficult, and only a little rougher. So it may be said that every man has a struggle of some kind in order to marry, and that there is a kind of fight or contest for the possession of every woman worth having. Taking this view of Western society, not only in England but throughout all Europe, you will easily be able to see why the Western public have reason to be more interested in literature which treats of love than in any other kind of literature. But although the conditions that I have been describing are about the same in all Western countries, the tone of the literature which deals with love is not at all the same. There are very great differences. In prose, they are much more serious than in poetry, because in all countries a man is allowed by public opinion more freedom in verse than in prose. Now these differences, in the way of treating the subject in different countries, really indicate national differences of character. Northern love stories and northern poetry about love are very serious, and these authors are kept within fixed limits. Certain subjects are generally forbidden. For example, the English public wants novels about love, but the love must be the love of a girl who is to become somebody's wife. The rule in the English novel is to describe the pains, fears, and struggles of the period before marriage, the contest in the world for the right of marriage. A man must not write a novel about any other point of love. Of course, there are plenty of authors who have broken this rule, but the rule still exists. A man may represent a contest between two women, one good and one bad, but if the bad woman is allowed to conquer in the story, the public will growl. This English fashion has existed since the 18th century, since the time of Richardson, and is likely to last for generations to come. Now, this is not the rule at all which governs making of novels in France. French novels generally treat of the relations of women to the world and to lovers after marriage, Consequently, there is a great deal in French novels about adultery, about improper relations between the sexes, about many things which the English public would not allow. This does not mean that the English are morally a better people than the French or other southern races. But it does mean that there are great differences in the social conditions. One such difference can be very briefly expressed. An English girl, an American girl, a Norwegian, a Dane, a Swede, is allowed all possible liberty before marriage. The girl is told, "You must be able to take care of yourself and not do wrong." After marriage, there is no more such liberty. After marriage, in all northern countries, a woman's conduct is strictly watched. But in France and in southern countries, the young girl has no liberty before marriage. She is always under the guard of her brother, her father, her mother, or some experienced relation. She is accompanied wherever she walks. She is not allowed to see her betrothed, except in the presence of witnesses. But after marriage, her liberty begins. Then she is told for the first time that she must take care of herself. Well, you will see that the conditions which inspire the novels, in treating of the subjects of love and marriage, are very different in Northern and in Southern Europe. For this reason alone, the character of the novel produced in England could not be the same. You must remember, however, that there are many other reasons for this difference, reasons of literary sentiment. The Southern or Latin races have been civilized for a much longer time than the Northern races. They have inherited the feelings of the ancient world, the old Greek and Roman world, and they think still about the relation of the sexes in very much the same way that the ancient poets and romance writers used to think. And they can do things which English writers cannot do, because their language has power of more delicate expression. We may say that the Latin writers still speak of love in very much the same way that it was considered before Christianity. But when I speak of Christianity, I am only referring to an historical date. Before Christianity, the northern races also thought about love very much in the same way that their best poets do at this day. The ancient Scandinavian literature would show this. The Viking, the old sea pirate, felt very much as Tennyson or as Meredith would feel upon this subject. He thought of only one kind of love as real, that which ends in marriage, the affection between husband and wife. Anything else was to him mere folly and weakness. Christianity did not change his sentiment on this subject. The modern Englishman, Swede, Dane, Norwegian, or German regards love in exactly that deep, serious, noble way that his pagan ancestors did. I think we can say that different races have differences of feeling on sexual relations, which differences are very much older than any written history. They are in the blood and soul of a people, and neither religion nor civilization can utterly change them. So far I have been speaking particularly about the differences in English and French novels, and a novel is especially a reflection of national life, a kind of dramatic narration of truth in the form of a story. But in poetry, which is the highest form of literature, the difference is much more observable. We find the Latin poets of today writing just as freely on the subject of love as the old Latin poets of the age of Augustus, while Northern poets observe with few exceptions great restraint when treating of this theme. Now, where is the line to be drawn? Are the Latins right? Are the English right? How are we to make a sharp distinction between what is moral and good and what is immoral and bad in treating love subjects? Some definition must be attempted. What is meant by love? As used by Latin writers, the word has a range of meanings, from that of the sexual relation between insects or animals up to the highest form of religious emotion called the love of God. I need scarcely say that this definition is too loose for our use. The English word, by general consent, means both sexual passion and deep friendship. This again is a meaning too wide for our purpose. By putting the adjective true before love, some definition is attempted in ordinary conversation. When an Englishman speaks of true love, he usually means something that has no passion at all. He means a perfect friendship which grows up between man and wife, and which has nothing to do with the passion which brought the pair together. But when the English poet speaks of love, he generally means passion, not friendship. I am only stating very general rules. You see how confusing the subject is, how difficult to define the matter. Let us leave the definition alone for a moment and consider the matter philosophically. Some very foolish persons have attempted, even within recent years, to make a classification of different kinds of love, love between the sexes. They talk about romantic love and other such things. All that is utter nonsense. In the meaning of sexual affection, there is only one kind of love, the natural attraction of one sex for them other, and the only difference in the highest for of this attraction and the lowest is this, that in the nobler nature a vast number of moral, aesthetic, and ethical sentiments are related to the passion, and that in lower natures those sentiments are absent. Therefore we may say that even in the highest forms of the sentiment, there is only one dominant feeling, complex though it be, the desire for possession. What follows the possession we may call love if we please, but it might better be called perfect friendship and sympathy. It is altogether a different thing. The love that is the theme of poets in all countries is really love, not the friendship that grows out of it. I suppose you know that the etymological meaning of passion is a state of suffering. In regard to love, the word has particular significance to the Western mind, for it refers to the time of struggle and doubt and longing before the object is attained. Now, how much of this passion is a legitimate subject of literary art? The difficulty may, I think, be met by remembering the extraordinary character of the mental phenomena which manifest themselves in the time of passion. There is during that time a strange illusion, an illusion so wonderful that it has engaged the attention of great philosophers for thousands of years. Plato, you know, tried to explain it in a very famous theory. I mean the illusion that seems to charm, or rather actually does charm the senses of a man at a certain time. To his eye a certain face has suddenly become the most beautiful object in the world. To his ears the accents of one voice become the sweetest of all music. Reason has nothing to do with this, and reason has no power against the enchantment. Out of nature's mystery, somehow or other, this strange magic suddenly illuminates the senses of a man, then vanishes again, as noiselessly as it came. It is a very ghostly thing, and cannot be explained by any theory not of a very ghostly kind. Even Herbert Spencer has devoted his reasoning to a new theory about it. I need not go further in this particular than to tell you that in a certain way passion is now thought to have something to do with other lives than the present. In short, it is a kind of organic memory of relations that existed in thousands and tens of thousands of former states of being. Right or wrong though the theories may be, this mysterious moment of love, the period of this illusion, is properly the subject of high poetry, simply because it is the most beautiful and the most wonderful experience of a human life. And why? Because in the brief time of such passion, the very highest and finest emotions of which human nature is capable are brought into play. In that time more than at any other hour in life, do men become unselfish, unselfish at least toward one human being. Not only unselfishness, but self-sacrifice is a desire peculiar to the period. The young man in love is not merely willing to give away everything that he possesses to the person beloved. He wishes to suffer pain, to meet danger, to risk his life for her sake. Therefore Tennyson, in speaking of that time, beautifully said, "Love took up the harp of life, and smote on all the chords with might. Smote the chord of self, that trembling passed in music out of sight." Unselfishness is, of course, a very noble feeling.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.